Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. Today's episode is sponsored in part by Highland Woodworking. Visit their website at highlandwoodworking.com. And also by Lee Valley and Veritas. Visit their website at leevalley.com. Hey everybody, welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop podcast. So this is the third part of a four-part series on the construction of a kid's bookcase made out of maple. And what we're going to do is let's go ahead and jump right back into the build session that we have going on right now. And then, of course, as we've done the last couple of episodes, on the backside, let's talk about some options for something that we'll see. So without further delay, let's go ahead and jump right in. All right, so now that we have the fixed shelf at the bottom all in place, I want to go ahead and I want to attach the top rails. So again, this is our back, this is our front. And to do this, again, we'll just use our clamping edge guide here. And then we'll just use the stock itself to help us set up the distance from the top. So that one is exactly where I want this to be. Double check that, okay. And then this one just needs to come up just a pinch. Since these are the same, we'll double check it. All right. Oops. And one more double check. Yep, and yes. Now with the fence in place, what I want to do is I want to have that top rail slightly set in just a little bit. So I'm going to go ahead and take this, and I have this tiny little piece of scrap. It's an offcut, and it's exactly the thickness that I want it to be set back a little bit. So I go ahead and I just simply put that in place so that this is flush with the front, and that means that the rail is in the position I want. Again, grab our clamp. Straight edge guide allows us to have something to clamp to. Hold that in position. And then now it's just a matter of putting it in place. Now we'll repeat the back. By attaching the back top rail, this first side of the bookcase is completely assembled. It's now time to carefully move all of this out of the way and get ready to attach it to the other side. We start by setting the opposite side down on the bench with the grooves for the shelf hardware facing up, then carefully reposition the assembled side onto it and line it all back up again. Dry assemblies are crucial in ensuring the real thing goes smoothly, so take your time and, if necessary, go through the steps you will do during the final assembly as many times as you need to so you know ahead of time where any sticking points will be that would cause you grief. Really, when it comes down to it, nothing is worse than discovering a joint you thought was perfectly fitted suddenly isn't, or worse yet, the component with the grain pattern and color you intended for the show side ends up hidden away, while the one you really wanted hidden, well, that one's out front and on display. Okay, so we have essentially the assembled body of the bookcase itself. All we need to do is make the top, and then we'll put the back in place, and then we'll go ahead and we'll make the adjustable shelves. Of course, that won't take very long at all because we essentially have everything cut to size. It's just a matter of putting it all together. Now, there is one decorative feature, I guess you could call it. This is just a very plain and simple bookcase, which is exactly the way the client wants it. And to be honest with you, I kind of like it. I like just the basic lines. I think it's really dramatic. Although it's very simplistic at the same time. Down here at the bottom, I want this fixed shelf look a little bit meatier. And my intention is to attach another piece, this one right here, to the front, to give it that little bit of thickness, to give it the illusion that it's a much thicker shelf. And the way I'm gonna do this is, I still want a little bit of a reveal here, and I thought, you know, I want a bit of flexibility going on with it to make sure that, you know, if there are any little quirks here in the shelf, if I had one solid piece like this, it'd be really difficult to kind of bend it the way I want to. So what I'm gonna do is, I'm actually gonna create a little bit of a lip so that what you'll see on top here is just a little bit narrower, but underneath it is going to be just a little bit thicker. So the first thing I did was, well, number one, I've got this cut to the dimensions I want. And as you can see in there, I went ahead and I created a slot. So we're going to head over to the table saw, and I'll explain a little bit more, because essentially we're going to cut out the lip and have the two shoulders that we need, and then we'll see how it looks when we put it in place. Okay, so over at the table saw, we're going to make two cuts. And of course, both of these we want to be very, very cautious about, because they're hidden cuts. So we're going to use some sort of push stick. In this case, I'm using Micro Jig's gripper to make sure that my fingers stay out of the way, because as we're coming out the back side of that cut, it's very easy, if you're not conscious about where the blade is and you're not using some sort of protective device, to have your fingers in the wrong position. So we had the blade raised up to the height of the thickness of the fixed shelf, and now that we have that, I went ahead, I made a second preparation with the fence to remove that material. Now, I apologize, because I already went ahead and I kind of made the cut while I was working on another piece, and it didn't even dawn on me until afterwards. So let's go ahead and get ready to make this cut, and then I'll show you what the lip looks like afterwards. We'll remove the scrap material. And here's that lipped piece that I was talking about. And let's go ahead and just simply put it in position. Just to give you an idea, we got to cut it to length. But it's going to effectively look like that. All right, so as you can see, the final assembly of the kids' bookcase is finally coming together. And in fact, what we end up doing is, in the next episode, I had to kind of skip ahead. We have the whole finish, or the project completely finished. We have the finish on it, the top coat, everything, and it's pretty much ready to go out the door for the client. In fact, that day the client was on their way when I was filming that last portion that we'll see next week. Really, the only thing that was left to do was to put the back on it, and that was just a matter of putting a piece of plywood, which was also stained to the same finish color, getting that in place, which really helped to make the project more rigid. But that's something that we can talk about next week also. Now, the thing I want to talk about today in our kind of options section, I think is what we're doing right now, is I want to talk about some joinery options that we have. Now, as you saw me assembling it, some of you are really not crazy about the fact that I did this. You don't see this as a traditional technique, which really, I'm not going to argue about whether it's historical or not. Pockethole joinery is a viable joinery option when you're constructing pieces. And the one thing I really like to do about this, and I think this is one thing people don't like about it, is, well, they're rather obvious. I mean, you can really see them if you were to flip the piece over, because when I use pocket holes, and I think I've tried to emphasize this in the past, I only use them in locations where they're going to be hidden. I don't want anybody seeing them. And you saw me put several on either side. It was really kind of overkill as far as I'm concerned. You don't quite need as many as I put in there, but I didn't want to take any chances with this, because I know this family, and I'm not saying anything bad about them, but you know what? There's a good chance that this thing's going to get pushed around and beaten. You know, it's something that they're planning on holding on to for both of their kids as they're starting to get older. So it's going to be around for a long time, and I want to make sure that it's going to stay together under all kinds of wear and tear. So that was my main reason for using the number of pocket holes that I actually did. So what are our options? What are the things that we could do if we want to use a more traditional type of joinery? Well, number one, the first thing that comes to mind if you are going the route of traditional joinery is to use a dado. And then, of course, you have your choice of using a stop dado or a through dado. If you're not familiar with dados, a stop dado is just simply a dado that doesn't go all the way through on the show face, or maybe even on the backside. Essentially, it's a groove, much like the grooves that we created for the shelving in the side panels. That pretty much is a through dado. So we could use that, and that would allow the, especially the fixed shelf, which is the main one that we were concerned about, to fit right in, and it would tie it in rather nicely. Some people would say, well, why couldn't you use a rabbet joint? Well, the problem with a rabbet joint is, sure, it gives you a shoulder which the side could sit on, but there's nothing really to help add the extra rigidity and help give it the strength that you would want if there was any of the pushing and pulling, which I was concerned with and why I used the pocket hole joinery. Anyways, so those are our two options, is the stop dado or the through dado. A through dado is just one that you would see on the front. You would see the actual piece sitting in the dado itself. Very strong, very rigid, would work really fantastic. So if you want to go the more traditional route, that's the route you could go. Another one that I think is considered kind of traditional, but again, some people might like, I don't know about that one, is just simply using like dowels. I mean, here's just a couple of dowels. Again, you depending on where you want to place them, how you might want to do it, it's just a matter of drilling corresponding holes in the mating pieces. Obviously, with the sides, especially the side panel itself, it's a little bit thinner, so you can't drill quite as far into that, but you can easily get it deep enough so that it would help to add a little rigidity. Essentially, it's kind of, dowels work very much like a floating tenon. They're just much smaller, so of course, you would, you can vary. I don't really have a specific on how many you need to put in place to add up to a certain strength. Typically, for most situations, if I have a rail such as a drawer rail that I'm putting into position for the front, I might add just two, and it would work out perfectly fine. So dowels is another option. I mentioned floating tenons. That would be another option. Essentially, it's just a really fat a dowel. In fact, actually, sometimes there are like 2, 3, 4 of these put together, and that would be an option. Another one, again, some of you really kind of poo-poo this because you don't really like them very much, is to use biscuits. We see our good friend Norm Abram using them all the time. And this one, too, would work very well in that situation. I might actually, because I did want to strengthen everything up, I might use maybe a few more of these. Maybe even if the thickness allowed it, I could like double them up almost sandwich-like. But considering the material we were working with, that wouldn't work quite as well on there. But I would definitely space more of these through there. One more option we have, and I don't have an example of it here, is to use the domino. I don't have a festool domino. If somebody wants to buy me one, I'd absolutely love to have one, but I do not have a festool domino, but that also would be an option that you would have. And again, depending on the material you're working with, would vary the thickness of the domino, the size that you would work with. Just like with biscuits, dominoes come in various sizes. So that's one more thing to think about. And essentially, biscuits, and more so with dominoes, they act very much like a floating tenon, which basically means you just cut a hole in one mating piece and a hole in the other mating piece, and it literally kind of floats between them, but obviously put glue in there and it holds it in place. So those are options that I can think of. If you can think of another option, I would love to hear about it. But with everything we work on, the design, there's always a way to kind of tweak a design just for the techniques that you're familiar with, the joinery that you have available to you, or it, you know, if it's something that you want to beef up just a little bit more, there's always options. So hopefully this kind of gives you an idea of things that you could do if, say, if you didn't have pocket hole joinery, or you're just really adverse to using pocket hole joinery. Well, these were just a few more things you could do.
To find the show notes and links mentioned in today's episode, visit mattsbasementworkshop.com. There you'll find information on how to subscribe to the show, enter our monthly swag drawings, and more. And while you're there, please consider helping to support the show by visiting our various advertisers and sponsors. By clicking on the links and making purchases, you not only have a chance to buy great tools and services for yourself, but you also have a chance to help support the show.